Welcome to the Blazor Scheduler tutorial, where I will show you how to perform CRUD operations using Entity Framework within the component. Entity Framework in a Blazor Scheduler helps handle data tasks like creating, reading, updating, deleting, and batch updating events, while loading events on demand allows for dynamic data retrieval based on user actions, making the scheduler efficient in managing scheduled data. In this tutorial, I will show you through the step-by-step process to achieve how to perform CRUD operations and load events on demand using the Entity Framework in the Blazor Scheduler. In this video, I will use Syncfusion and Microsoft packages to perform CRUD operations in the scheduler. First, let me open a Blazor server app. I'll begin by installing the necessary packages to perform CRUD operations using the Entity Framework. Open the NuGet package manager and install the Syncfusion Blazor Schedule package. Next, I'll install the Microsoft Entity Framework Core package, which facilitates seamless interaction with our database. I also install the SQL Server package using Entity Framework. This step is vital for ensuring that our application works seamlessly with SQL Server. Finally, I install the Entity Framework Tools package, which provides essential tools for managing migrations. Instead of using controllers, I can implement a custom adapter to handle the interactions with the database. This custom adapter will help the scheduler component communicate with your data source, allowing you to perform operations such as querying, creating, updating, and deleting data within your scheduler application. Now, I need to add a model class to represent the data structure. To do this, I create a new folder named Model. Inside the Model folder, I create the class named Appointment Data. Inside the Appointment Data class, I set the properties such as appointment subject, start and end time, and other related properties. To handle communication between our scheduler application and the database, I create the Appointment Data Context class inside the Data folder. I'll start by including the Microsoft Entity Framework Core namespace. This namespace provides us with the essential tools and classes to work with our database. Next, I inherit from the DB Context class provided by Entity Framework Core, which acts as the communication bridge between our application and the database, allowing for easy data management. Additionally, I create the Appointment Data Context constructor, which supports configuration parameters to fine-tune database interactions. I include the model namespace for access the Appointment Data Model class. Also, I define a property called Appointment Dataset within the Appointment Data Context class to simplify data operations. This property represents a collection of appointment data entities in the database, facilitating querying, insertion, updating, and deletion of appointment data records. Next, I specify the database connection in the app settings JSON file using a connection string that contains server details, the database name, and security credentials. Next, navigate to the program CS file. I include the Microsoft Entity Framework Core namespace. I register the connection string using the SQL Server. This configuration step ensures that our application knows how to connect to the database securely and efficiently. Next, I will add code-first migrations. These migrations automate the creation of a database based on our model. The necessary Entity Framework Core packages for migrations will be added to the .NET Core project setup. I open the Package Manager console and run the migration command. This command will generate classes that support migrations. You can find these migrations in the Migrations folder, automatically created based on the command. Finally, apply these changes to the database by executing the command update database. Now I'm going to check that the database has been created. you'll notice that the appointment data database is created, complete with an appointment dataset table containing columns based on the fields defined in our model. Each time we make changes to our entities and execute a migration, you'll see new migration files created in our solution and new entries in the EF Migrations History table. Now, I'll demonstrate how to perform data populating in our database. Data populating allows us to provide initial data during the creation of a database. To achieve this, I override the onModelCreating method in the Appointment Data Context class to specify the structure and initial data for the appointment data entity. This method is called during the model creation process and allows us to configure our entity using the model builder object. I can specify the initial data for this entity by invoking the hasData method on the entity appointment data. Now let's run the migration commands once again, this time updating the initial data. After executing the migration commands, make sure you check the database. You'll notice that the database has been updated with the provided initial data. Next, I will demonstrate how to create a data access layer. First, I create a new class named Appointment Data Service within the data folder. Include the necessary namespaces such as Microsoft Entity Framework Core namespace and the model namespace to access the Appointment Data class. Inside this class, I declare a private read-only variable named Appointment Data Context of type Appointment Data Context. This ensures that the Appointment Data Context field remains constant after initialization. Then, I create a constructor with the same name as the class, accepting a single parameter, appDBContext, of type Appointment Data Context. This constructor sets the appointment data context field to the value of that appDBContext parameter. Inside the constructor, I set the appointment data context field to the value of the appDBContext parameter. It is used to store the provided appointment data context object. Then I implement a public asynchronous method named get that returns a list of appointment data objects. This method requires two datetime parameters, start date and end date. It retrieves a list of appointment data objects from the appointment data context based on the provided date range. The scheduler offers flexible data binding capabilities through the SF Data Manager component. It efficiently connects data sources to the scheduler, handling data requests and responses, and includes built-in adapters for various sources like OData services and web APIs. In case these built-in adapters don't suit your needs, I will show you how to create a custom adapter to manually manage data operations. First, I create a new class named Appointment Data Adapter within the data folder. It inherits the Data Adapter class and acts as the base class for the custom adapter. Inside this class, I declare a private read-only variable named AppService of type Appointment Data Service. Then I create a constructor with the same name as the class, accepting a single parameter, AppService of type Appointment Data Service. I set the Appointment Data Service field to the value of the AppService parameter. I include the model namespace for access the Appointment Data Model class. Inside this class, I declare a list of appointment data objects named EventData. Then, I create the override read async method. It takes two parameters, data manager request, which represents a request object for retrieving data, and an optional key parameter set to null by default. In this method, I extract the start date and end date values from the data manager request parameter. I use the get method asynchronously to fetch appointment data between the specified start and end dates, and then store the fetched data in the event data list. I return a result based on the requiresCounts condition. If true, I create a data result object with the result set to event data and the count set to the count of items in event data. If false, I simply return event data. Next, I navigate to the program file. I registered the appointment data service and appointment data adapter as a scoped service, which means a new instance of the appointment data service will be created for each HTTP request within your ASP.NET Core application. This is a common way to manage data services within the application's dependency injection container. Next, I navigate to the index file. I have already added the Syncfusion Blazor Scheduler component and bound it to the T-value property set to the appointment data class. If you want to learn how to get started with the Blazor Scheduler component, check out the video linked in the YouTube card above. Now, I define the Schedule Event Settings tag and set the T-value property to Appointment Data Model class. Inside this tag, I define the Syncfusion Data Manager component to provide a data source to the scheduler. You will notice that I have specified the adapter instance property with the type of appointment data adapter. Additionally, I specified the adapter property as custom adapter. Let's run the example application. As you can see, the scheduler rendered with the provided initial appointment data. Next, I will show you how to perform the insert operation along with database changes. Inside the appointment data class, I implement a public method named insert. That takes an appointment data object, appointment, as a parameter. Inside the method, I create a new appointment data object, app, and assign properties from the appointment parameter to it. I added that app object to the appointment dataset within the appointment data context asynchronously. I save the changes to the data context, effectively inserting the new appointment. Next, I navigate to the Appointment Data Adapter class. Inside the class, I override the insert async method, which is used to insert data into the data manager. Inside the method, I call the insert method using the app service. After the insertion operation, I return the data object. Look now, as you can see, the scheduler rendered with the initial appointment. Now, I've inserted two new appointments, and you can observe them being scheduled. When I check the database and reload it, you'll notice that the two new appointments have been successfully added. Next, I will show you how to update the existing appointment along with the database changes. Inside the Appointment Data Service class, I create an update method that takes an appointment data object, appointment, as a parameter. It retrieves an existing appointment with the same ID as the appointment parameter using the asynchronous first async. If no such appointment is found, it will be null. If an appointment is found, it is removed from the appointment data set and the changes are saved to the data context, effectively deleting the existing appointment. Then, I navigate to the Appointment Data Adapter class. Within this class, I override the update async method, used to update data in the data manager. Inside the method, I call the update method using the app service. After the update operation, I return the data object. Look now, I'll update an existing appointment. After making the update, a quick database reload will confirm that the appointment has been successfully modified. Next, I will demonstrate how to perform delete operations along with database changes. Within the appointment data services, I implement a delete method, which retrieves an existing appointment with the same ID as the appointment parameter using asynchronous first async. If no such appointment is found, app will be null. If an existing appointment is found, it is removed from the appointment dataset, and the changes are saved to the data context, effectively deleting the existing appointment. Next, I navigate to the Appointment Data Adapter class. Inside this class, I override the remove async method, which is used to remove data from the data manager. Inside the method, I call the remove method using the app service. After the removal operation, I return the data object. Look now, I'll delete an appointment. Once deleted, a quick check and database reload will confirm the removal. Next, I will show you how to perform batch update operations along with database changes. Inside the Appointment Data Adapter class, I create an override for the batch update async method, used for batch updates involving changes to multiple records at once. This method takes parameters such as changed records, added records, and deleted records, representing data that has been changed, added, and deleted. It begins by initializing the records variable with the deleted records, focusing on records marked for deletion. The method checks if deleted records can be cast as a list of appointment data and processes each deleted record. Use the delete method to perform the deletion. Next, the method checks if added records can be cast as a list of appointment data and processes each added record, using the insert method to add the records. Finally, the method checks if changed records can be cast as a list of appointment data and processes each updated record, using the update method to update the records. After updating, the method returns the records variable, which contains the records based on the actions taken during the batch update. Look now, I'll add recurring appointments and set their titles along with recurrence counts. These appointments will be scheduled accordingly. After checking and reloading the database, you'll see that the new recurring appointments have been successfully added. Lastly, I'll delete a recurring appointment. Once it's deleted, a quick database check and reload will confirm its removal. In this video, I covered a step-by-step process to achieve how to perform CRUD operations and load events on demand using the entity framework in the Blazor Scheduler component. For more information on Scheduler's features, check out the documentation link provided in the video's description. If you want to see the working code of this example, you can download it from the GitHub link in the description below. I've also provided a link where you can see if you qualify for a free community license to use all our Blazor products. If you found this video useful, click the like button and subscribe to our channel to watch more videos like this. Thanks for watching.